So in this class, I am going to discuss about ASIC and FPGA. Although these two topics are quite vast, not possible to cover in 15-20 minutes, but I am just going to give you an idea which will help you to distinguish between these two points whenever and wherever you find them on your learning journey. So, first of all, the definition of ASIC. So it can be expanded to application-specific integrated circuits. So its definition is like this, that it is an integrated circuit and it is designed in such a way that it meets the exact requirements for a specific application. And the specific application depends upon what you want to design. It can be MP3 player, it can be mobile, it can be particular laptop. So how it is being designed? IPs are being picked from different companies. IPs means intellectual properties which are being designed by them. So they are in possession of their ICs. Suppose you want to design a mobile, then you need a processor, you need network ICs, you need other ICs, analog to digital converters. So all of them are being from different companies. So you purchase the IPs and you will design that IC with the help of that. So another point about ASIC is it is a fully customized device. Why fully customized? Because we have pre-layout out standard cells. So libraries are available with that. That I have talked with you people already, IPs, intellectual properties, and large number of functionalities are available. So you are just picking them and using them. So standard cells are available, you are just using them. So saving a lot of time in optimizing each and every cell. There are certain points related to ASIC that product which have mass market, then ASIC is choice. Otherwise, it will be very costly to make a ASIC. So example are your mobile, then MP3 players. There are certain advantages of ASIC. So these are, if you are designing ASIC for a very big market, mass market being used the term, then low production cost is quite low. Otherwise, production cost is on the higher side. Another point is it helps in utilizing the resources on the chip in a best possible manner. So it is always being a tendency of designer to use all the resources in a best possible manner so that resources does not go wasted. Now when we talk about ASIC, this entire thing is being optimized for a specific application. So when we have optimized our thing for a specific application, so therefore power consumption of ASIC and size will be very, very less. So this is just a general overview of ASIC. There are other things. Some of you might be confused with what are standard cells. So standard cells, libraries and all. Some of you may not be understanding these points right now. But later on when we discuss the course, you will get them to your vocabulary. Just for idea, standard cells being you have already designed some particular functions like ALUs, your sequential circuits, your combinational circuits, and you are directly using them. So they are being stored in the form of libraries. You are directly using them. So you are not designing them, because if you start designing them of your own, the cost will go on the higher side. Also, there is a time involved in designing that. So you will be always on the losing side. So that's why ASIC are being preferred. And the only thing you have to pay is you have to pay royalty to the company so that you can use that particular application of different company. Like all the companies are using Qualcomm processor. They might be using NVIDIA drivers. So why they are using? Because they are paying something to that particular company. Now, as far as your ASIC is involved, there is a specific development process. So it is called ASIC design flow. So the first thing in this series is algorithm. Now, what is inside the algorithm? So in algorithm, what you are supposed to do is you will be describing the behavior. So behavioral description of specifications. Behavioral description of specifications. That is what you are supposed to do in algorithm. So it may be related to your device which we are designing. So first thing is behavioral description. Now once you have done that, then you will implement that description in terms of some hardware description language. Or you have very good simulators. These days simulators are quite good. So instead of writing codes, we have schematic. You have used Multisim or other software where you are directly picking and placing the components. In the earlier days, we have to write the code. So similarly, you are writing the codes for VHDL and Verilog, but now in some simulators, you can directly use schematic entry. Now, once you have implemented your function in HDL, then you will be interested in checking out the functional simulation, whether your system is performing in a perfect manner or not. If not, then you will start looking forward what's gone wrong with your design specifications or your implementation in hardware description language is missing something. Although your code is fine, it does not have any errors as far as syntax is being there. But as far as functionality is being concerned, you are not getting the exact thing. So that we will test in functional simulation. So once you are sure that functional simulation is okay, then the next thing is logic synthesis. So what do you do in logic synthesis? So you write code in HDL, you go for functional simulation, then in logic synthesis, what you do, there is a tool and it will help you to generate gate level netlist. Gate level netlist. Because in HDL, you will just write the behavior that if this is equal to this, this is equal to this. And so many other things are there. So corresponding to that, your gate level netlisting is generated. So once your logic synthesis is over, the next step in ASIC design flow is gate level netlist. And that is being generated. So after that, you will go for post-synthesis simulation. That means your synthesis is complete. Your gate level netlist is being generated. Now you want to test whether this thing is being okay or not. If not, then you will take modifications all. Because once your thing is actually being implemented in hardware or you have made the layout for that, it is going to be very, very difficult to change or make any alteration in the initial things. So it's better to go for changes in the beginning. Otherwise, you will always have some sort of error while designing. Now, after gate level netlist is being there, the next thing that is very, very important, that is logic verification. So in logic verification, what you will do, you will verify the functionality of the design. In logic verification, what you will do, you will go for functionality of the design. This is the next thing you do. So after logic verification, you are sure that whatever you have done is fine. Then you will go for mapping, placing and routing of the components. And once your mapping, placing and routing on the IC is done, you will go for timing simulation. So in timing simulation, we will look forward for delays related to your system and other aspects. And after that, your mapping, placing and routing and timing simulation is fine, you will go for physical layout. That means this entire thing is actually on your software, and now it is need to be converted into IC. So this information is being transferred to fabrication lab, and they will generate an IC corresponding to this. So those students who are interested in front end, back end, so this is your front end, and this is your back end. So here you will just working on the software portion and only on the behavioral thing. But after, once that is being done, then it is related to hardware. But it is related to how it is actually going to be implemented. Then what we will do, we will actually call this particular thing backend. So many softwares are there to do this particular synthesis and to design ASICs. So you might have listened about them, you might have used about them. So they are Cadence, it is Synopsys, and Altera is also one of the software, and Magma is other software. So much work is being done in this particular field, and you can get yourself trained and work in this particular field. So this is all about your ASIC development process. So that's all for ASIC development process. In the following of this class, I will be discussing about FPGA. In the meanwhile, if you have any doubt, you're free to discuss your doubt with me so that we can get some idea whether you are getting points or not.